Mini panjang. Oh, he's sorry. Good morning, Emmanuel. If you would stand and worship the Lord with us this morning.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above.
God, thank you so much for this day. I pray that it'll bless you and that we can all go about our days with joyful hearts and attitudes and a good heart posture. We love you and we can't wait to see what you have for us to hear today from Pastor Pat. And I just pray for many blessings for the rest of the week. In your name. Amen.
Thank you.
Romans 8, it says, "No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, Jesus Christ our Lord."
Without power, sin, or shame.
may we just ever exalt you and ever praise you and glorify you alone.
Jesus on the cross, it is finished. And as we were just singing that, that just really impressed upon me. It's finished. Everything that's needed for our salvation has been accomplished in Jesus Christ. And we can just rejoice in that. We can boast in that, his death and his resurrection. So just pray. And we just, as we are closing our singing portion of our service, we want the words that we've been singing to really sink into our hearts, that they would be true and experience the grace of God in our lives. So let's pray together. Father, just thank you for your grace, Lord. We know that, Lord, that Jesus paid it all, and therefore all to him we owe. And as we've given of our offerings, Lord, to you financially here this morning, as we offer ourselves up in worship and gratitude to you, as we open our hearts and pour out our lives as a drink offering to you, we pray that it would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight as our act of worship to you here this morning. So we thank you, Lord, for gathering each one here. We pray that this would be a meaningful, continue to be a meaningful time in your presence. And we pray that there would be just joy this morning as we sing and hear and listen and respond to your spirit and all the ways that you have for us here together as a church body. So we love you, Lord. We just ask for your continued guiding and directing on our time together. And we know that all that will be accomplished in your will, according to your spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, just a few announcements for you here this morning. And just thank you for our worship team and guiding and leading us in the worship. We have an engaged couple here today. And so we just want to congratulate Josh and Abby. If you guys would stand up for a moment here. That's good. You didn't know I was going to do that. But we do celebrate marriage, and we're just grateful for what God's doing in your lives here in your families. All right, a few other things here. Just welcome. We have a few visitors or guests here today, so welcome. Glad you guys are here. And some things coming up in the life of the church. This coming Sunday, we have our outdoor service. So it's our second one. It's kind of the last hurrah for summer, most likely, because it's end of August. And so we wanted to do one more outdoor service. Everyone seemed to love the one that we did, the first one. This is the first year where we're doing two. And so I want to make sure that you are aware of that. We will not be here in the building. So we will be at the same location that we were at last time, down by the Bear River Pavilion right there. So the information is in your bulletin. I'm going to pass this around. This is a sign-up. It's an outdoor service and picnic. So Zach is going to start us off here. And sign up, if you would, if you know what you're going to bring, and just so we can get an idea. You guys can have an idea. Make sure that we don't have 100 salads, and we have just a good mix of the right things for the picnic. All right, and then a couple things for the men and the women. So men's retreat is coming up, and you can see in your bulletin just a reminder about that. I think the announcement's gotten out, but if you have your payment, Pastor Pat is accepting that, and we want to help you with that too if you need help. And also, if you're worried about transportation or just needing to carpool, caravan, we're going to be planning that. But please see me if you do need a ride for sure, and we're going to work out all the logistics for getting everyone to the men's retreat. And not to be left out, the ladies are having a luncheon. So we have three ladies, Sonia, Tanya, and Wendy, that are going to be teaching and bringing dish to pass. So Pastor Bob and Sonia are, Sonia, I'm sure, would be giving that announcement. They're at their granddaughter's baptism this morning, and so that's why they're not with us. All right, and then house to house. So we're going to be starting up house to house starting the week of September 17th. We have 5 homes this time, which is amazing. So thank you for the host, our group leaders that are going to be serving in those ways. So on this clipboard, there's actually 5 sheets. So I want to make sure that you see that there's 5 sheets. You can flip through. We have 3 homes that are going to be on Wednesday, 1 on Thursday, and 1 on Friday. So I'm going to pass this around, and we want to encourage you to be a part of it. One of the ways that we can really grow as a church, just in numbers and all, but spiritually, is really the house to house. It's a way to spread out in a way that we can grow that way. And we don't have a midweek study at the church building. So this is our kind of midweek way of gathering, of getting people together, and looking at how do we apply God's word in community together. So I'm going to pass these around, and please sign up, or if you have questions, let me know. We'd love to get you plugged in and be part of the house groups. Okay, and then Tanya, if you could come up and just give an announcement on our kids club and also the Sunday school for kids that's starting up.
Friday, 5 to 8, we love having everybody, and dinner
off, please let us know. We'd love to have you. So you see in your bulletin that there is a Sunday school supply list. So yes, that means we are working on getting Sunday school started up again for our kids from about 4 to 12. We have teachers, and we actually have space, so God still works miracles. The list in here, we thought we would start off by getting a supply wish list for you because we know that the back-to-school sales are going on right now, and a lot of you are already buying things. So if you want to pick up some items that are on this list, that would be awesome. We'll have boxes up front for you to drop them off.
All right, so yeah, praise God. If you can bring supplies in, like I said, the box will be up here, and we're excited. We have lots of kids, and so we need to have opportunity to be able to invest into our kids here. All right, so with that said, we're going to have our little ones go down for nursery, 5 and under, down to nursery. And Pastor Pat's going to come forward, and let's prepare our hearts for receiving God's word today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Titus chapter 3, please. Near the end of your book. And I am liking this over here. I'm going to have to address, if I don't look right enough, it's not because I don't like you, it's just because I forgot you were here. You're too busy coloring anyway, it's all good. All right, let's start off this way. We'll read it in a second, but I want to hear from some of you guys. Name a couple things, one thing in your life that changed when you became a follower of Jesus. What do we got? Your friends? That's a good thing. Who else? Your values, okay. Something that changed in your life when you became a disciple of Jesus, when you got saved. Okay, you want to be serving more? Cool. What else?
Conviction over sin.
Yeah, conviction over your sin. Very good.
Habits.
Desires. Desires, yeah, right in the heart. No one said bank account yet, which is awesome. So that's great. We must be teaching the right. It probably got less, maybe, because he started giving to a church. Let's hear a couple more. What changed? What changed in your heart? Yes, and joy. We can struggle to have joy. What was that? Compliments? Is that what you said? Tolerance. Okay, sorry.
More prayer and more reading the Bible.
Yes, very good. Yeah, some deepness. Yeah, well, we probably hear a couple deep amens today from you, so we'll be reminded. Guys, the reason I bring this up is because something that changed big for me, and we're going to see it in Titus 3, is the way that you start looking at other people. Now, that's a change in your heart, but it's also exterior, because when you become a believer, all of a sudden, you're around all these people that aren't believers, right? Because your life has changed. You will become around believers in the church, obviously, but now your life has changed, and maybe your inner circle obviously doesn't, not everybody just vanishes right away, obviously, and we're told that we're going to be in the world, but we're not going to leave the world. We just have to be not of the world, so we're going to be around unbelievers, and we're going to be around some pretty nasty people, and things are headed that way, right? So Jesus, in our lives, he takes away addictions, drugs, alcohol, pornography, right? He removes all of that from our lives. He's provided direction for us as Christians to make proper decisions. He guides us, whether that's with marriage, finances, profession, education, where you're going to live. God starts to really guide you with some practical things like that. The list goes on and on as to what, like, exterior changes have been made in our lives when we've been called by Jesus. But I think there's one thing we might miss sometimes when our focus becomes completely fixated on what Jesus has done for us personally. So what I want to talk about is what he's done for us that starts as a Christian to be revealed and how we move out around the people around us. Because Jesus gave us two commands, right? We can boil it all down to two commands that he gave us, which is to love God, which we all want to do that one. That's why we try to be holy. That's why we try to read our Bibles. We want to love Jesus. But then it's love everyone else. Love your neighbor. Who's that? Well, it's the people around you. Love God and love others. And let's be honest with ourselves for a minute. Some of us can probably be pretty mean to other people. Is that possible? Andrew, you ever been mean to anybody? Not to me, anyways. Some of us can get a little nasty from time to time, and I get it. But But if we're honest with ourselves, maybe we haven't been treating the unbelievers around us with the kindness and love that we should. Now, the Bible doesn't really use the word mean. I get that. I don't think I'd find it in that context. But I'm not naming names or pointing fingers, but who doesn't get this way sometimes? And I'm not saying we get this way as Christians because we aren't thinking about Jesus or trying to live the Christian life. But I do think we start to treat other people improperly when we boil the Christian life down to what has Jesus done only for me. If we become so fixated personally on that, we might become a little bit ineffective, because Jesus didn't come to just save you, right? You're not the only one. I'm not the only one. We might think so sometimes because we get caught up in our Jesus feels and we want to just hang out with him all day, but he didn't come for just you. He created a church. He created a kingdom. The Bible says he created a holy nation. But guess where that holy nation is currently residing? In a very unholy nation, in a very unholy world, right? We're not just caught up in the clouds just yet. We're still in this world. And this section of Titus has a really a generalized yet specific command for Christians as to how we should live among the rest of the human beings around us, because there's a lot of them, regardless of who they are and regardless of how we feel that day. If you have a bad day, it doesn't just excuse the way you decide to treat people that day. But on top of that, as the Bible usually does, it gives us a command, but then firmly anchors that command in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So this isn't going to be, I'm not up here to tell everybody to be nice to the people this afternoon. I'm telling you why we should treat people with love the way God has treated us with love. So let's get into the Bible here, but we're in Titus chapter 3, but I do want to preface the content from 3 with a reminder of where Titus is in his ministry. So we have Titus chapter 1, verse 5, says this. It says this right here. I'll look in my Bible. This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. So Titus is hanging out in Crete. Now, if you jump over to verse 12, he says, one of the Cretans, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons. Is that the person sitting next to you today? Maybe. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply that they may sound in the faith, not devoting themselves to Jewish myths and the commands of people who turn away from the truth. So he's talking about rebuking, if you jump up to verse 10, people of the circumcision party, the Jews that are invading and intruding into the church as well. But verse 12 there, liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons. So, this sounds like a pretty rough area with some unlikable people who are probably living a full lifestyle completely contradictory to the way Titus is trying to help his church live a lifestyle. And there's people from the Jewish circumcision party that are deceivers, are promoting myths and other dangerous teachings to the church. So the church in Crete is surrounded by Jewish radicals that are distorting the gospel, leading people astray, as well as these pagan people from Crete who are liars, beasts, and gluttons. And what does Paul tell Titus to do? Does he just say, raise up arms, we're going to war? If you remember that scene, this is what I thought of from Lord of the Rings when Sauron's out on the balcony with all the Uruk-hai out there, and he's like, to war! And that's what I think of. I almost put the GIF on the screen today, but I didn't. And yes, it's called a GIF. It's not a GIF. It's a GIF. I almost wanted to put it up there because that's how we want to feel sometimes, right? These evil beasts around us, they vote different than me. They're in another political party. Let's go to war with these people, right? Well, most conservative commentators you might listen to would say something like that, right? But what about the Christian ones, right? What about the Christian people? What do we have to say when we're concerning the people around us? He doesn't say, let's head to war. He says this in chapter 3, verse 1. Remind them to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, to show perfect courtesy toward all people. Well, dang it. That was not what I was hoping for when dealing with these evil beasts of Crete. To show perfect courtesy, to speak evil of no one. This is a little bit tough, right? But let's look at each one of those lines in verses 1 through 2. And we'll pick them apart quickly. Now, these are not the people in the chapter 3 that Paul is concerned about the false teachings that they're bringing into the church. These are the unbelieving average people around that are just lost in sin. So Paul's not telling Titus to treat these people like he would tell him to treat the false teachers. With the false teachers, he's much more harsh. But with the lost people around him, Jesus has a tremendous heart of love for them, and we have the privilege of potentially leading them to him, so this is how we should treat them, okay? So the first one, in verse 1, submissive to rulers and authorities. We see this all over the New Testament. In Romans 13, he says, be submissive to governing authorities, for there is no authority which God did not establish. Then he says, honor the emperor, honor Nero. We want to ask ourselves, even in 2023? Yeah, even in 2023, unfortunately. Even in 2023. I think sometimes we think it'd be nice if there was a little expiration date on some Bible verses, but I looked really hard, even in the cross references, and I could find no expiration date on this one. So be submissive to rulers and authorities. Number 2, be obedient. Well, obedient to who? Well, children, be obedient to your parents. Employees, be obedient to your bosses. As Christians generally, let's be obedient to God and the Scripture. Amen. Ultimately, that is the goal. The third one, ready for every good work. Now, what good works has God called us to? One of my favorite verses is from Ephesians. I love this verse. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So this is awesome because it's really personal but really general. So as a church, we have a lot of good works that God has prepared for us to do. But you can also think about it personally for yourself, that when God formed you in your mother's womb, what good works was he preparing for you to do? And that's where you can start to get really intimate with the Lord and walk with him in obedience if you know what his will is for your life. But as a church, we need to be ready for every good work too. Like being ready to explain the gospel to those that God has put in front of you, or serving everybody that God brings our way as a church with prayer and finances and support and truth. We want to be the light that God has called us to be in the Scriptures as a church. But then us personally too, what good works has he called us to? What good works has he called us to do among the evil, sinful people of the world who we'd rather walk away from? The fourth one is speak evil of no one. So for those of us whose lips can get away from us, I'm guilty. Proverbs 4:24 says, put away from you crooked speech and put devious talk far from you. So don't let it even hang out on your doorstep. Put it far from you. And how do you know if you're speaking evil of someone? Ready? You know when you're speaking evil of someone. That is the only diagnosis, the only formula I have for you. You know when it starts, especially if you got the Holy Spirit, you know. And let's start nipping it in the bud. Let's stop speaking evil of people. And he says speak evil of no one, but remember, he's talking in regards to these pagans, right? Don't speak evil of them. What's the point? And so this is kind of tough, right? We have to start wondering when we're just analyzing the world and when we're really speaking evil of people. Proverbs 12:13 said, an evil man is ensnared by the transgression of his lips, but the righteous will escape from trouble. The next one is avoid quarreling. Now, when I think of quarreling, I think of a bunch of elementary school kids on a playground that somebody got pushed into the wood chips, and now there's a little quarrel going on. Unfortunately, this is the way that adults can act, too, over silly things, and we can start acting like school children. But when Jesus tells us to become like children, he's not telling us to start quarreling like children on a playground. He doesn't want us to argue and bicker over stupid things. I think the vast majority of things that we get into quarrels about, if there was one person that had like a 5% interest in taming the situation and really giving an effort to avoid a huge problem, all of those problems would probably go away. But we can all think of people we know, or maybe ourselves at times, that just don't have a desire to not quarrel. We like it for whatever reason it is. People like to get into it. But Paul says, avoid quarreling. If you see it happening, you walk around it. Because if you're trying to avoid something, it exists. So when you see a quarrel, get around it. Next one is to be gentle. So instead of fighting like school kids, we're going to be gentle with each other. We're going to be gentle with unbelievers. And we look at Paul's writings, they seem so straight up, so hardcore, like he's not scared of sharing the truth. And they are, but if you remember what the Corinthian church thought of him, they said this in 2 Corinthians 10:10, They say his letters are weighty and strong, but his bodily presence is weak and his speech is of no account. So Paul would show up and they go, this doesn't sound like the tough guy that was writing all that stuff to us in our letters. And there's maybe a few reasons for this. I mean, maybe Paul could have been sick, tired, exhausted, whatever it means. Or maybe more likely, he was just a humble, nice, gentle, kind guy with the church who he loved. And I think that God worked through that and the Holy Spirit could accomplish things with Paul that he himself could not. And I think many of the world's most respected leaders that have had the ability to be powerful and influential also knew the importance of having a tender and gentle spirit. Abraham Lincoln gave bold speeches, military commands. He helped lead the Union through the country, through the craziest time we've ever had, probably. Imagine if Texas was fighting Michigan. Like that's a crazy time to lead the country through. And you know what? He was most well known for being introverted, humble, and gentle. He even coined the phrase, malice for none and charity for all. Yes, even those Confederates down there. Charity. Because we want unity, right? The last one was, show perfect courtesy to all people. Be meek, be humble, express kindness to everybody. And this is more than holding the door open for the cute girl behind you, as much as we like to think that that's what we've been called to. Paul affirmed in these statements that those living in Titus, in Titus's town, there were lazy gluttons, liars, and evil beasts. And Paul said, yeah, I read that, and I don't think I'm going to argue that. That's what they are. You might think he would say, well, that seems kind of mean. Why? No, he said, that's who they are. I'm not going to argue that. That's who's living there. So my question is, how courteous to you are the evil beasts in this area? I'm not trying to coin people from this town that. That's why I did air quotes. There's a lot of great people. But how courteous are you to them? How meek have you been toward the pro-abortion people that you know? How much humility and kindness have you shown recently to the person at work or school who's going under gender-affirming care right now? How meek and kind have you been to those people that vehemently oppose your worldview? How kind and meek are you with them? So we could decide to close up our Bibles right here, head out to the world this afternoon, and try to do our best with the only reason being because God said so. And we might do all right for a bit, but I think striving to obey the commands of God with the only purpose and motivation being because God said so, that's a really good way to get exhausted really fast. And there's something deeper that God has for us. So God gives every lifestyle command, every character enhancement that God wants for us in the scriptures. He's not asked with just the purpose of moral growth. It's always rooted in something so much more foundational and something that can't be moved, and that's what we see in Titus 3:3. So let's read Titus 3:3. This is why. He says, do all these things because we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others, and hating one another. Have some of us forgotten who we used to be? Maybe it's time every now and then to meditate on that. You might want to know a simple and reliable way to change your perspective on people you might just have some sort of hatred for. And the most simple way I can give you is, I was a fool. I also didn't obey God. I was lost. I was addicted to things. I wasted my days away in ungodly living. People hated me, and I hated them. So is the person I'm dealing with in my life really that much worse than I was? And the answer is obviously no. You're not dealing with anybody in your life right now that you need to sit down and make a chart of all the things they've done wrong and then make a chart of all the things you've done wrong and then try to measure things up. But the simple fact is we've all fallen short of the glory of God. And the second we grip so tightly to how amazing we think we are now that we've been saved, to the point that you start to mistreat unbelievers, we've missed the whole point of the gospel. Paul intentionally reminds the church, you were awful too. So you know why you can be patient with that pro-abortion fanatic? You know why you can love that person that hates Jesus? Do you know why? Because you did too. And it's really not any more complicated than that. And we might say, yes, but they've done this and they've done that. Well, that's the point, actually. Because we've done all those things too. And the second we start to walk away and have some sort of expectations for people that are living in the world that we shouldn't have those expectations because they've never shown interest in Christ before. We don't need to become so frustrated over it. And any time we inappropriately loft ourselves above those who are still rejecting Jesus, I think we've forgotten the fundamental truth of Christianity, which is that we didn't save ourselves. Chapter 3, verses 4 through 7. But when the goodness and loving kindness of our God and Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing and regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So not were our lives only indistinguishable from others before we were saved, but even when we were saved, it had nothing to do with our works and righteousness, but everything to do with God's mercy. Amen. Through the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. The second we look out at people and think that they're beyond God's mercy, we've totally forgotten the message that he first gave us that changed our lives completely. So can we read passages of scripture like this, which is great gospel content? This is rich stuff. We can feel all sorts of gratitude for it. Thank you, Jesus. I remember when I was saved. And then really go out into the world and struggle so hard to show similar love to other people that God showed for us. Jesus can hang on a cross for me, but I can't lovingly serve others. I walked into this church in early 2015. It's over 8 years ago now, which is crazy. I was lost. I won't describe every detail that was going on in my life then, but I was lost. I didn't think I was lost. But that usually just means you're more lost than you think you are. But I was welcomed with love. People were patient with my pride. They supported my enthusiasm, even though it was a little off base. They were courteous toward me. They taught me the gospel in a way that I didn't even know I was really being changed. And I bet you there was a few times during that where they looked at me, Pastor Mark, Pastor Bob, everyone else. If I didn't say your name, I still love you. They probably looked at me, Nathan, and thought, yeah, Pat's kind of being a cocky idiot right now. But I remember when I was 19 too, and I remember when I didn't know Jesus either. It doesn't have to be any more complicated than that. You don't have to call everybody out on every little thing. You have to guide people, walk with people, try to be a master at working with where people are at and bringing them to Jesus. The passage we saw today is interesting because as Christians, we often hear we need to let go of the past. Like we have this view of the past that it's kind of like taboo and don't want anything to do with that. And here's a couple quotes that I just thought we would look at today. Don't judge me by my past because I don't live there anymore. If you have a t-shirt with this on it, I'm not making fun of you. Let go of the past and the past will let go of you. I get these. I get the vibe of these. I would, you know, we're going to be printing mugs for sale after service. These are nice, right? I get it. But I don't want to look at my past as so taboo and strange that I can never leverage that for other people. I get what these are saying, obviously. We shouldn't be defined by what's happened in our past. But I'm also not trying to forget what's happened in the past either. Paul made a point to remind the church in Crete how terrible they all used to be. You were foolish. You were disobedient. You hated God. People hated you. You hated them back. He didn't bring that up so they could revel in it or be shameful in it, but he brought it up to help them learn how to treat people outside of the church. Another quote says, when the devil reminds you of your past, you should remind him of his future, which is pretty fire. I like that one. But hey, the devil could remind me of something from my past, and I might say, hey, thanks. I actually totally forgot about that. I can actually use, I totally forgot that was a part of my life. I'm going to use that to help this person get saved. I'm going to use that because I see this person going through a similar struggle. I'm going to leverage that, actually. Thank you, devil. Now you can stop talking to me now. I'm not afraid of that. I'm not afraid of my past. I don't know if you guys are, but don't be afraid of your past. Jesus has transformed that, if he has, if you met him and given your life to him. And you don't have to be afraid of those things. chapter 3 and verses 4 through 7, it gives us four outcomes for ourselves personally, right? He says he saved us, we received the Holy Spirit who he poured out on us, and we receive justification as we're justified by his grace, and we become heirs to Christ in his kingdom because of the hope of eternal life. Salvation, justification, the presence of the Holy Spirit, and eternal life as heirs in heaven. That is an awesome list. But are these gifts meant to end within themselves? They are not. Let's finish with verse 8. The saying is trustworthy, and I want you to insist on these things, so that those who have believed in God may be careful to devote themselves to good works. These things are excellent and profitable for people. So to one another as a church, let's start insisting on these things to one another. Hey, stop speaking evil of them. That's enough. We don't need to do that anymore. Let's show perfect courtesy. Hey, why aren't you being more kind to that person? Don't you remember who you used to be? We can insist on these things with each other and the commands that come along with it. So in this context, these commands are really to love your enemies the way God loved you when you were his enemy. And it gives you an answer why, and the answer at the end of verse 8 is because these things are excellent and profitable for people. So there is your scriptural promise from Jesus that when you do these things, when you do those commands from verses 1 and verse 2, it's genuinely good for people, and you're accomplishing something profitable for their soul. And there's not much more fulfilling in the Christian life when you've put some work into somebody's life to really try to present something profitable for them in the gospel, and you really start to see it catch some ground and gain some traction in their life. That is an awesome feeling. And you might not see that happen all the time, but the Bible says if you do these commands, it will be profitable for them. Maybe you won't see any fruit of it because maybe you'll die before it happens, but God is telling us it's profitable. So when you submit to rulers and authorities you'd rather not submit to, it's profitable. When you stop speaking evil, it's profitable. When you show courtesy to people that the world tells you to hate, it's profitable. And that's your promise. Let's have the worship team come up, please, and I'll just finish with a couple things. Might need to pass that baby off, Bree. I want to encourage everybody here by let's acknowledge together as a church, so we don't need to hide from reality, we don't need to hide from truth. The world right now is being formed and shaped by forces that can make commands that we read today a bit more difficult, right? You can think of all the reasons right now why you don't want to do those things from verse 1 and verse 2. And the world is being formed to make you think that way. They want us, I don't care who you vote for, what side of the aisle you're on, both forces want you to, like, hate other people. That's what everybody wants, because it feels good, and it makes you feel empowered, and you're the virtuous person. Church attendance in America is plummeting. It's been plummeting. It's on the trajectory to keep plummeting. So if you cling to your Christian convictions, you might just be labeled as a Christian nationalist bigot. And guess what? You're going to have to be kind. Depression, anxiety, suicide, addiction are all up, so you might just say the wrong thing at the wrong time to the wrong person, and you might just get snapped at. And you're going to have to be kind. The sexual revolution, LGBTQ, is alive and well. You see it, and you will. I promise you, it started to happen in my life. You will have people in your life that are going to jump on board with it. Whether they're coworkers or extended family or whatever, whoever it is, they're going to jump on board, and you're going to need to learn how to navigate that with love and gentleness. You're going to have to figure it out. And the scripture has a lot of great stuff to say about helping out some people that could use Jesus. I might have to switch. I only got a few more things to say. We can make it. All these people in the world are being told that you as a Christian hate them, that you hate them. Christians are out to get them. And why do you think churches throw the flag up, right? Because they're trying to virtue signal to the rest of the community that they have a safe space there that the other churches will not provide for them. Because the other churches hate you, but we don't. So be encouraged that this isn't time to be fearful, to engage with the lost. I actually am decently excited about it. I have an opportunistic spirit that all these people that struggle with these types of things are going to be in my life to some degree because they need somebody. and we can be that person. You don't hate them. You can show this. You don't hate them. You love them. You're not going to judge them unbiblically. You're going to make a claim about the standards of Christ that they've missed, but you can share to them that they can run to him. So I think a great goal for us as a church to go out and be the church that the world is telling unbelievers that we can't be and that we won't be. We can show them that that's false. And I believe Jesus will bring a lot of fruit through that. Because it's really satisfying to go out and be the Christian the world tells you that you aren't. And you say, yeah, I am. Yeah, because Jesus. All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for giving us your word and these commands that you gave to Titus and his church. And we want to succeed in them as well. We want to treat other people with courtesy. And Lord, this isn't some kumbaya, coexist, tolerance message that we want to share with the world. We want to go out and show them that they have missed a standard in Christ, that we also have missed ourselves. And we can all think of the types of people today that we would rather lash out at from time to time. But I ask that you give us patience in our hearts, that you give us courteous spirits, so that we can go out and show meekness, gentleness, and humility to people that will always be more impactful than being, you know, an unbiblical way. Thank you for saving us, and I pray that if anyone here today has not given their heart to you, that you would spur them on to do that. And we're excited to take on what the world has today, but we're going to do it with love and gentleness. We pray in your name. Amen.
Please stand and we'll end our day together here in worship.
I believe in you, your spirit is within me.
forgot to mute my mic during that song, so hopefully you have me muted again. Or it's going to sound terrible online. Yeah, it's going to sound terrible. At the end of Jonah, Jonah's all mad that his plant's gone, right? And he says, God said, you do well to be angry for the plant. And he said, yes, I do well to be angry, angry enough to die. And the Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, but it came into being in a night and perished in a night. Should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who don't know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle? God had a lot of mercy on a lot of people who were living in a lot of sin because they didn't know their right hand from their left. So let's start looking at some people in our lives, in our world, in our country, that just maybe they just don't know their right hand from their left, and we can show some mercy. Amen? All right, have a good Sunday, guys.